please. We're ready to begin. Our last talk for today is about Debian release management by Andreas Barth.
Okay, so I will. Does it work, the microphone now? Good. So I will just start now. For the first slide, for the first part, I don't really need the slide urgently, because actually everybody of you should know what I'm talking about, at least if you manage to go through a new maintainer. But well, still it's important that we all share the same information. In Debian, we have more or less different distributions. Usual packages are uploaded directly to Unstable. From Unstable, they get, after some rough testing, go into testing. And from time to time, we release this testing to Stable. The former Stable becomes old Stable. And there's something else also. That's called experimental, where packages can be uploaded that shouldn't go to testing and shouldn't do harm in Unstable. So that's one of the basic things what we do about testing. Okay, so you need full screen and you need, yes, that's the right slides. FL. Yeah, so, okay, now be just, okay, there's a command line option for it. I learned on the other thing. So, can I have a shell?
Right click on the background. On the
like this one. So, it was XPDF, I think, with a full screen. Okay, thank you very much for having the set of another laptop. Full screen. And it's mounted to where? Oh, great. Okay, so now there are the slides, at least on my laptop. You can't see them, but they can be fixed. I think that's one of the very typical things with the release. We are ready, the others are not, but we have learned to cope with that. Is it something with the laptop? I'm just... Function F8 usually does it. F5? Oh, yeah, there. Oh, yeah, that should. I don't mind if I don't see anything here, but the people should see something. Okay, so just let me take a look at my next slides so that I can have some ideas. Let's just remove the function so that I can see. Okay, so what's the target of the. Let's continue. What's the target of release management? Release management means we must make sure that actual testing meets the release targets. We must make sure that anything that happens with testing doesn't break testing, and that if testing is broken, we unbreak it. We have to keep the strings together with testing. And one of our most important tasks actually is to collect and distribute information from one team to the next team. So okay, now it's starting to get to the point of time where I would like to see you be able to see my slides.
We actually have a laptop. Can we have the laptop from up there?
So okay. So I will tell you something about who is the release team, who does the release. That are five persons: two release managers, Steve and Colin, and there are three assistants. And there are three release assistants. Oh, great. Thank you very much for it. So now we can continue with this nice slide. Three release assistants that Troy has, who mainly focus on the Debian installer. You all know him. That is Frank, and that's myself. Oh, there's something else. What did happen now? I don't touch it with somebody else. I guess it's something with I see this control monitor just changes its layout. Perhaps something is happening there. At least we have, so the release team has. Oh. Okay, we'll just continue. Never mind. So the release team has a common role account. That's Debian release at list.debian.org. Everybody could subscribe to it who is interested in it. But please keep in mind, this is not a discussion list. There are more populated places. And the basic reason for it is that everybody in the release team is supposed to read every mail that's sent to this list. And if there's a discussion, that can get quite ugly for us. So please don't do it. And there's a website for us, release Debian.org. It's not as full-blown as we hoped, but there's still a lot of good information on it, and I hope that, well, we will improve this website. So if you think there's anything missing, please just ping up one of us on IRC or send us mail or whatever, and we'll add it to the website. So what are our tools? For testing migration, we have the famous script called Brittany, which is actually not a script, but a combination of shell scripts, Python, and some C backends. I learned a lot of Python, but well, okay. And it's an important tool for interacting with Brittany. For us as a release team, are the so-called hints. With the hints, we can add packages, we can remove packages, we can say, okay, the package might be too young, but please bring it in anyway. So that is the gateway to Brittany as a hint. We have release critical bugs. For most of you, you consider them just, say, block release, but actually, they're very, very, very valuable tool for us because we know where we have to take action, and they are a most important management tool. And for that reason, we have two different websites with telling us how the SE bug status looks, a bit different because the different looks have different advantages. We have also now a page on security status, which is maintained by Joy Hess as part of securing the testing distribution. He will give another talk about it, but that is also one of the very valuable tools for us. And besides these major tools, a lot of small scripts and tools that we use, Madison, Grip Deconsole, and a lot of all other small scripts that are very helpful for us to get the release done. So how packages go into testing? One thing I really want to emphasize for all of you is we prefer if it goes via unstable, even if you're in a deep freeze. The basic reason for that is that in unstable, the package gets some rough testing. If it got updated to testing or post updates, which is also possible, well, more or less nobody tests it. And for that reason, the patches need to be very, very, very minimal. And there are even cases where said, oh, yes, that's a bug, but we won't fix this via testing or post updates. Sorry. Because it's too risky for us. The testing script, Brittany, is run shortly after deinstall. Deinstall is a script that just takes the packages that are in incoming Debian.org, installs them into the pool, and pushes the mirrors. And shortly after that, we run Brittany, makes a testing transition, but you can see the results only after the next day. We, however, directly publish the output and excuses of the Brittany run. So if somebody asks a question, the output says, it's going in, but it's not in. Well, it is in. You will see it on the next day. Don't ask us in the same day about it. That's more or less the most frequently asked question I ever heard. And what we can done, but we don't really like, is we can run Brittany during the day if there's some urgent issue. For times like now, we just say, oh, well, if we run another time next tomorrow. But if it's just something like, oh, half a day before release, we do it. So now the question is, what worked well? I think that's a very important question for all of us. What worked very well is the Debian installer. It's from the manageability point of view much better than it was before, at least as much as I heard, because I've never done anything with bootflop except installing one potato system upgraded to Woody. But other people who have more experience, that is much better. We have, and that I can say from my own point of view also, very decent management tools that we used during the freeze. We have very granular hints. For example, in previous times, it was just possible to say, okay, this package is not ready, but this package goes into testing anyways. That, of course, is nice, but it's not all, because you can by accident break some other packages. Now I can say, okay, this package is ready, but please ignore that it's too young. It still checks that it doesn't break other packages, that it has no SE bugs, so that's much better than it was before. And there's another small script called D, and I can just say D space package name, and it tells me what's the difference between unstable and testing. And also, if I finish reviewing the differences, it just gives me the outer right hint to put in my hints file. So that was a very nice tool for coping with a few hundred unfreezing requests per day. So also, we have very decent bug squashing tools. The view of the release critical bugs improved very much. We have the sargignore, now edgeignore hints, text to the bug report, which we can use to say, okay, we don't consider this release critical right now without having to play funny games with the bug status. That's also something So it really helps us because it avoids all these things, avoids that we make mistakes. Because we don't we have to check less things, and the rest is done by the computer. And computers do only mistakes when you tell them something wrong. What also worked very, very well is the partial freeze. We started with freezing some packages and intended it to more and more and more packages. And in the end, the full freeze was only a very short period of time, and still the release is very stable. So that was a great helper for all of us, and I think also a great help for the package maintainers, because it's easier if they don't have to go an extra round around the management and the release team to say, oh, please push the package in. And frankly speaking, with the large numbers that Sarge has, and that Edge really also has probably, it's almost impossible to have a longer full freeze than this very, very limited time we had. What also worked, at least in our opinion, quite well, but in the end, that's your call to make, not ours, were the regular release updates via Debian Devel Announce to keep all of you in the loop. That's also, of course, helpful for the release team, because we have to make a lot of difficult decisions. And if you are in the loop and know why we do it, it's easier to just get them done. So it's, I think, good for all of us. Something else that we had to do, but it worked out fairly well, was this time planning. We said, okay, we have some date N in the future where we don't know when it is, but depending on the date N, we will do some actions. And that worked out very well in the end, better than we had hoped. Also, a very nice thing for us was that we had experimental. For example, the whole GNOME 2.8 transition was done experimental, worked, and then done in unstable. And I've never ever seen such a smooth transition of such a large number of packages into from unstable to testing. I think the transition was complete something like 12 days after the first upload. And if you remember that it's 10 days to minimum wait time, well, there's nothing else can be said about it anymore. It really worked very, very well. Another thing that we had very long was an NMU policy with 0-day NMUs allowed. Actually, I think that helped to keep Debian as a whole in a very good shape. And to say, oh, well, packages are first, of course, a responsibility of the maintainer, but in the end, packages are the responsibility of the whole package, because a package is represented how the packages work, good or bad. And I think we should continue something like that. And in the end, also managing the release at large was very, very successful. Of course, there were a lot of glitches that I don't like, and then we come to those glitches very soon. One of the things that really could have been a bit better was the way that only a very few maintainers work with us. But it's really important to remember, don't second guess how our freeze guidelines are. We publish them on Debian Devel Announce, and we do it for a very good reason. Don't just stop on a random IRC channel and say, can I upload a breaking upload to unstable right now and break a transition with it, which has happened in the past. Not only once, I'm afraid. Also, please don't upload a package so you say, oh, yes, that's a new major upstream version of this library that's not intended for Sarge, and then you upload it to unstable. That's not good. So if you upload anything that's not meant for the next stable release, upload it to experimental. That's the place it's meant to be, not to unstable. And please don't upload a package. If we are right in the middle of a transition right now with the C++ or we were with TIFF, and if the release team says, please don't upload, then please, we really mean it. Don't break the transition with it. And something else, actually, everybody should read Debian Devel Announce. But if you upload a package where a lot of packages depend on, please make sure they really did it. At least, especially if the message is more than 1 week old. And we ask, please don't do it. And there's a lot of other small points. But I think the summary of all of them is, if you're a good maintainer and are just doing what you should do, communicate with other maintainers in a good way, and just speak with the release team, then everything works well. And if there's anything, you can always ping any of us on IRC, on a mailing list, that's always okay. So just do it if you're unsure and ask us, and we will give you the right answers. But of course, there were also other things, which more on the management point of view, which could have worked a bit better. The first point that really hit us very bad was a large number of unfreeze requests we had in the final stage. It was really, impossible to read Debian release at that point of time. And I just said, okay, at that time, some days I just read Debian release and nothing else anymore. Usually I read a large number of mailing lists because there were just too many requests to cope with. We need to get better at that point, definitely. Also, the base freeze was a bit long. We started with the base freeze in August last year. At that point of time, we expected to be a release about December. And it was sensible to make the base freeze because it was needed to get the installer shaped up finally. So it was not a wrong decision at that point of time, but if we would have known what we know now, we probably would have done it a bit later. Also, there were perhaps a few packages too much in the base freeze. I don't really see any reason why we need to base freeze MUT, for example, just to name one of the examples. And we already discussed it. We will improve at that point. Also, one of the questions is, which development packages should be frozen a bit earlier? Because we don't really consider it as fun if the CDBS maintainer makes an upload 5 days before the final freeze and breaks such a lot of packages building and such. Yeah, that's not really funny. So you will also probably freeze this package. Other packages like NetPaper were not frozen, but the maintainer was clueful enough to not do it, which may be reason because it's part of the release team, but well, never mind. So what we also definitely want to have is a version check on Bugstep in org, so that we can say, okay, which SC bugs are actually open in SART, not to say, okay, which SC bugs were either open in any distribution or were uploaded and the maintainer reopened it. Actually, the code for that is there, and I really hope that that Colin managed to commit it or to make it productive very soon. And that will also help us with the very first point, because now we had to say, oh, if you upload an RC bug fix, you must send us mail or we won't get it into Sarge. For Edge, we can say, if you upload an RC bug fix, never mind, we will find out by ourselves. And that is very much easier for all involved parties, the maintainer and the release team. Also, we want perhaps a little more padding at the end so that it can happen the release too early, because it's not really fun to write a mail and say, oh, actually we want to release the day after tomorrow, but we will need another week. But of course, it's better than to say nothing, so we send that mail, but yeah, we should do better. Also, we had a madness on Monday with the deal downloads, where everybody tried to find out where's a mirror that didn't prevent downloads of the CD images this half hour before we actually released it. And that was really awful because the CDs didn't really install because the mirrors were not pushed. We need to do better than that. And we definitely need to do better with a final QA of the release and the CDs. And one of the things would be, so, well, this time we just said we have the release more or less ready, but didn't change the symlink. Then we built the CDs from this pre-release status. One idea of that would be to say we make everything, including changing the symlink on FTP master, build the CDs, and publish afterwards. But that would mean for all of you that there will be no deinstall about for 1 week or so. I think we can cope with it, and it would be better than have another CD HLOA release. But some people probably won't like it, and we will have to discuss about that. That's from the release team's point of view, it's good. From other points of view, we will see. Also, we should use more often the code names when we speak about the release. Because we could, for example, have committed to the installer 2 months ago that just, in any case when it installs, it just installs security with Sarge updates. So we wouldn't have never had such problem. So we should have perhaps done it, and also at other parts. Yeah, but we need a bit more control over how Britney works, because there's things that still don't work. For example, if someone says, please update my package, I say, well, it's fine, but I want to say it waits 20 days and unstable before it goes in. Well, currently I really can't do it. There's only one way to do it, to just write in my calendar, do it, add the hint on this day, and I do it. We should have a hint to say, okay, this package is okay, but the waiting time is 20 days now. Just as one example. Something else, what should definitely work a bit better than this time is the security I have after the release. I think 1 week is okay, 1 month not. And I'm better sure that we all agree on that and that we will work on that. So that's not only a release team possibility, but as I said before, one of the major tasks of the release team is just to keep those things together, speak with everyone involved, and that's relevant for the release, so we have to speak with everyone involved. There are more things we want to do better than Edge. The very outstanding issue is we really want to make a time-based release. We want to release in December 2006. That's a goal that we set for ourselves. And we already started on making changes that allow us to meet the goal. One of the most important changes is we don't have a large list of things that we said, oh, that all are release targets. No, we said release targets are as few as possible. Of course, we need a new toolchain, Xorg. Well, docs in main, firmware in main, I don't want to say what's my opinion on it, but we didn't have a choice because the developers voted. And there were a definitive opinion on it. So we have to trust, have to do it. Portstep in orgs, it is a split of the mirror in two parts. This is, in my opinion, very, very important. Our understanding is that the FTP master, it's important to get AMD64 in. And for us, AMD64 is really a release blocker. It was very bad to release Sarge without, and it is not possible to release Edge without. And something else you want to have is secure apt, but that's almost, uploaded to unstable, and I hope the remaining issues are sorted out. At least I'm very optimistic that we will meet these things in time. There's a bit larger list of things that we would like to see. So we called it pet release goals. That doesn't mean they're unimportant. It just means we are probably, at the moment, not holding our breath for them. But if it happens that just one or two packages don't comply with them, we can still say 2 months before release, okay, now they're blockers because we're not holding this target up for one or two late packages. Something else that was really very bad for us, we have a lot of dependencies between package renamings, especially libraries, transitions, and if it comes with build demon, it's really very bad for us. So we must improve on that, definitely. And currently, all packages have to wait to go to testing till all packages are ready. And that just can be very ugly, especially if some nice things come together, like, something like libtiff, KDA is then related with GNOME and with some other packages. It's really ugly. And we decided to just keep the old libraries a bit longer in testing, because in this case, we can just let the packages just flow in by themselves, and we don't need to take care of them at all anymore. And Enson is actually started to work on the code for this. Also, something that needs to happen is just more quality assurance, and that's a part that really everybody can join. So if you want to work on quality assurance, you're very invited, and this is the most important thing, because quality assurance, quality assurance, QA. So if you do it, because that makes sure in time that everything works. And for example, one of the things you want is that every package is automatically tested if it really installs. So that if it installs and uninstalls, that means are the scripts okay? That's already been worked on, but there are a lot of more things one can do. And if one has a good idea, please feel free to work on, and we'll definitely support it. Also, one thing we must make sure is we want to have less pain with some specific arch. Let me just tell you what I mean with that. For example, what has happened this time, we had one architecture where from one day to the next, all build demons just dropped off the net, which is very, very bad. And then we started to hint at the machines, and then I was informed that one machine was somewhere in Europe, near a certain city, and then I got on IRC in the IRC channel of that regional Debian language channel, and said, okay, any one of you living near that city, yes, you, okay, please go to your car, drive to that place, pick up that box, and install it somewhere with network access so that Elmo can install a build daemon on it. And frankly speaking, that is not the task of the release team. I don't want to say that I want less architectures. I'm happy with this number of architectures we have, and even with more. If we have, 15 minutes is pretty okay. That's my last slide already, so. But it can't be the task of the release team to keep up all the architectures. If the porters do a good job, I'm very happy with it because I like to have more architectures in Debian than we have. But if they do a not so good job, perhaps we just have to say one day, okay, two possibilities. Either the developers manage to get, for example, a second Spark build daemon up, or we need to add it to the architectures we don't really care about anymore. It's not meant bad, but it's also even meant better than it was now because in previous times, there was not really a discussion how it's changed, and now we really want to say, if it's bad, we will tell in time so that it can be fixed. Spark is actually one of the architectures we're really very bad about currently. So then, I think the general impression which architectures are bad and the ones which really hurt us are different. If you don't mind too much, if it's a question how I meant something, please say, but otherwise, I prefer questions after the talk. And so there's just four more points on this slide, so, okay? So,
and please raise your hand so I can get up to you with the microphone.
Yeah, I think if there are many talks, we just start at this point and go on the other side, so you don't have too long ways. Something else we want is a better interaction between the kernel and the installer. Actually, the interaction was much better than it was with boot floppies, but there are some things that can be improved. Because currently, if we do a security update for the kernel, we need more than, I think currently 3 to 4 rounds of rebuilding packages and wait till some are installed and rebuilding again, because there's sort of many dependencies. And actually, what I really would like to have, we have one source package, you change the code, upload it, and you get ready packages for all architectures just falling out of the build daemons, because that's why we have build daemons. Also, we need a bit better UDEP handling in Brittany, because currently, all packages that produce UDEPs, that are the packages for the installer, are frozen for one simple technical reason, that if we update such a package, one of us needs to plot an FTP mask and say, please update this package in the UDEP file also. Which is, well, should work automatically, because that's not too hard. Also, we decided to make a checklist with dependencies to say, okay, if we go into full freeze, for example, we need to make sure that we start now and working on the release nodes, because the release nodes are just necessary to be finished when the full freeze is finished. And we don't want to have a full freeze much more than 5 weeks. And so the release nodes really need to kick off now. Also, we want a pseudo package for release nodes right now, because if any maintainer makes a change in one of his packages that should be part of the release notes, he should be able to just file a bug report right now and forget about them, and it will be picked up again when the release notes are prepared. We learned a lot about that. A question of understanding, or can we avoid one more point? So then, as the last thing, we want to communicate better with all developers, with other maintainers, with other teams. And for that reason, we want to improve the information on the releasedep.org website a bit. For example, we want to have a list of current issues, of current policies, where, for example, now it should list, please don't upload any package which is C++ unless you speak with Doku before for the transition, so you don't break the transition. That would help, I think, maintainers a lot. But we are not at that point yet. But to the general question that we were asked quite often, are we there yet? Yes, we are with Sarge there yet. We managed it quite well. And we will be with Edge in time. OK, so thank you for your attention. And now I expect some questions. So who all wants to ask a question now? OK, I see a lot of questions. Yeah, we can just say there. Ben has already had the keynote question yesterday in my other talk. So give it to someone else. And I have one thing I really would like you. As I guess I expect a lot of questions, please don't make code statements. Just ask me your question. And if there are more detailed questions, we can just continue to talk about them after the talk so that everyone has a fair chance to ask me a question. Thank you all.
Hello. Okay. Well, assumed, can you? Yeah. Assumed the release team would have a really nice dinner and the food is contaminated by some salmonella. And all the people of release team would be sent to the hospital for four weeks. Is there any documentation which would help to replace the release team completely?
Well, actually, I would say there are far...
I do not wish you any hurt, but...
Well, actually, I would say there are far worse things. I can remember a car drive where all FTP masters with me were sitting in the same car in Vancouver.
Yeah,
but you'd be alive, so. No, you don't know car crash in North America. Well, actually, there is a lot of documentation, of course. But on the other hand, we have a lot of persons who are not in the release team who know a lot how it works. For example, France really helped us a lot and knows a lot how it works. The same is true for Zobel and for a lot of other people who are just around and help the release team. So the worst thing that can happen is some food contamination here, but thanks God the two release managers are not here. a lot of things are documented. On the other hand side, a lot of things are, you learn a lot of things if you do it. And one thing is, nobody with good management skills grows on the trees. We need more people who can do good management in Debian. And I think the release team is one of the teams where it works better. But of course, there's a lot of things that can be improved. And I think that's a major answer on it. On the other hand, please reconsider. At the time where the last DevConf was scheduled, I was not even a developer. So that was the reason why I was not there. So it happens quite fast if you can come in, yes? Next question, please.
Yeah, it's a different topic. As you probably know, I'm Petter Einarsson from the School Linux project. We have been using Woody and are still using Woody for the schools in Norway, and one of the issues we have been forced to face is the lack of hardware support in the stable release. This is a major pain because Sarge will slowly be harder and harder to install on modern hardware. Do you have any ideas on how to address the stable release hardware support?
Well, okay. If you just ask for ideas, that's very easy. I have a lot of ideas. Thank God you didn't ask for solutions. So, okay, there are a lot of different things. So one thing is a stable release means it is stable. There are good reasons for it. And for example, if we say we support a new kernel, then we would have to we need to do secure support also for the kernel. There are good reasons to support a new kernel, but well, my information at least is that this would mean a rebuild of the installer, and you can get a lot of fun with it. On the other hand side, I don't think it's too bad to say after, let's say, half of the time we expect till release of Edge, we add a new kernel set. I'm even considering to do that perhaps via volatile, but please don't side with that, because it's not, yeah, it's just, I'm considering if it's too to do, and I think there's one thing that can be worse than no new kernels, that is if we do it bad. So, but yes, that's as ideas to go, but for example, if you add new kernels, you need to add a new UDEV, for example, so you need to place some packages around, because the current kernel model is, so we don't have a stable kernel, but they're just, well, I would say, development snapshots that you can take or leave, whatever you prefer. So, yeah, not too nice, but that's the way it is. Okay, so the next question.
Any more questions?
So I think now we go over to Overfend.
Hi, I had a couple of questions. The first one was, you mentioned a pseudo package for the release notes. I'm wondering, why don't we just make them a real package? Have them, you know, they wouldn't be base necessarily, but Debootstrap could install them. That way the users would always have them. But that's less important than just, you know, unless you really need to be updating the package, like the
day before. Okay, well, I should just answer. The answer is, please ask Franz Popp. Franz Popp said to us, he considers it better that way, and so this team just trusts the opinion of other people, as always.
I'll repeat. If
the release notes will be updated until the very last moment. Translations will be added until the very last moment.
Even after the release.
Okay.
Okay, I will say.
Okay, the answer is...
I will repeat now.
Oh, I was going to do that.
Well, thank you. I'm giving the talk. Thank you very much.
Yes,
all right. So, Franz's answer, which of course was the right one, is that the release notes are updated very late. So they are uploaded even after the archive was frozen, because this time we frozen the archive at Saturday around, I would say, 2 o'clock UTC. So the release happened on Monday sometimes. And the release notes really were updated a lot of during the week, and I can remember at least 3 calls or translations, if I remember correct. So you see, and it would be bad if we have an installed package that has outdated information. So that's one of the basic issues. Other packages are more more tied at developers, like the developers of friends are in there. So.
Okay. My other question was, one of the things I'd been kicking around was the idea to make put in volatile. I know you haven't approved this. Was I wanted to make a stripped down version of Xorg that just builds the Xorg server to put it in volatile, because my ass got so burnt over all the complaining that we weren't moving from x86 4.3 even with patches to the drivers to support more hardware. And, you know, therefore, Debian was, you know, fundamentally inferior to Ubuntu, and we all just suck. And I know I had the support of the release managers in staying with x386, and none of us expected the freeze to go as long. If we don't use volatile for this, what do you recommend? Because it's something I'd like to do. I think it's something our users would appreciate. And if somebody's willing to do the work, can we maybe do it in volatile? Because it doesn't change external interfaces the way the kernel does.
I will just answer.
Because the kernel guys screw with stuff and break all the modules.
Well, okay. That would be, of course, an easy answer, because I'm just currently just having my release team hat on and volatile is an official service. But I don't think that would be a fair answer. So I will now just switch on my take on my volatile team hat and say, okay, actually, yes, I think it's possible to put it into volatile. we have a volatile two sections. One is the section where we say, okay, there are only the very easy ones, like currently Glamour for Glamour data. And the other section have a, say, okay, we can update, we can publish packages there, but they're not installed by default. So we make extra hint for up to say, okay, not selecting by default, only if the admin selects it. I think for that section it would be okay, but we should perhaps talk about that, not right during the talk about details on that.
Right, okay, okay. Thank you.
So Jesus is the next one, I think. And then there's one there, okay.
Who's next?
Jesus, here.
Okay, sorry.
So the question is the job of the release team to drop an architecture? I mean, if the job of the release team is not to make phone calls to a place in Europe to get one box, move it to 100 kilometers and reinstall, why not drop the architecture, make the release, not have to wait 2 months, and then do a point release 1 month later when they're...
It's okay, now a set of different questions. I will cite different answers. So first one is, in my opinion, it's the task of the release team to make sure that the Debian release are as good as possible. And it's, of course, different people have different markers for as good. There are some people with the marker to say, okay, we want on a very, very good predictable, as Peter said for in his talk about HP, for example, that's a very important thing, also in our opinion, because not only for companies unpredictable, but it's also for our private life unpredictable. We say, well, I will take this weekend off, and this, and this, and this, and this. That is fast too much. So we all need predictable releases. We want all to have as much good architectures as in as possible. We want to have as few bugs as possible, as fairly working as possible, everything else. And so in the end, the release team has to set priorities and to say, okay, we have now conflicting priorities, and we decide which one wins and which one loses. And I really hope that it won't be a time when architecture loses. But let me just finish that. But if that happens, if we say there is an architecture that can't keep up or that breaks us too much, we might say, okay, this architecture will stay in testing, but we will just ignore it for any purpose of testing migration. So that, well, if it works, it works. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. And if it stays too long in that state, then it will just, from the zombie state, and one day, perhaps after 2 months or whatever, you say, okay, now it's really broken. Nobody picked the task up to repair it. You will kick it out. For example, that has even happened in the past with Sarge, but just nobody noticed. Because we dropped the support for C86 processors before single season. Well, GNU-libc was uploaded with a patch that requires E486 instructions. That's necessary for speed and for compatibility with other distributions. So there was no discussion about whether to unroll the patch. And then there was a kernel patch that worked to emulate this. But this kernel patch is unfortunately a root hole. So we said, okay, there are two ways. Either somebody fixes it, or we drop the support. And we set that on Debian Develop Announce, I think, for 3 times, and nothing happened, and we just dropped the support now. It still works, but it's not officially supported anymore, and that might happen with other architectures. And about adding a package at the point release, there's something very bad on that, because I will tell you why. Because the great advantage is that of Debian is with the different architectures, I can say, okay, I have here some blocking of some certain version that works on this laptop very well with Sarge. Then I go to my ARM box and works the same same version works well on my ARM box. And if you say you added it later, that probably means there are some problems with the architecture, like the toolchain was not ready or so, but then you have different packages. So they behave different, and we lost much of that. I don't say it's not possible to make a snapshot of another architecture, but just believing that it's easy possible to add in full architecture as a point release is at least problematic, I would say, at least problematic. And but in the end, that's even not the call of the team the release team that I'm part of. We have actually in the release team two different targets. One is the stable release, that is Martin Choi Schulze. The other is a testing release team where I'm part of. And in the end, it's the call of Choi. And all of you who know him, we know that he will say in a much more definite way that this won't happen. I understand the reasons, and I really think it's not so good to say, oh, we added sometimes later, but if there's an issue, we need to fix it. And we need to fix it soon. And for example, how should it work if you don't have really a porter team who keeps care of an architecture, and we notice later on that there's a root hole in the kernel specific part of that architecture, who should fix it if there's no porter team? So that doesn't work. It's very sad to say it, but sometimes one of the release team managers has to say there's things that doesn't work. Okay, next question, please.
Yes. I might be a bit slow, but I didn't quite get the explanation why you couldn't update a packet in the release just before you released it. The release notes is a packet, and you, the release team, can't update a packet in the release. What's happening?
Okay, I can tell you how the release really worked in time with time slots. About on this time, about Saturday, about, I guess, 14 UTC, Nuro said, okay, you have two packages open. Please push them to FTP master right now, because the install will start after you did it. I de-uploaded them, and in about 10 seconds after that, an extra deinstall run was started to install the packages that we needed. An extra Britney, a whole terrible Britney run was done. And after that, Britney was put off the ground tab so that no more updates or testing were done. The usual deinstall was done about half an hour too late, and then there were some rough checks, and then Volon said, okay, CD teams, start building your CDs right now. And from that moment on, so the release team can't do anything except say, it's so ugly, we unsold it and do the release 1 month later. And we didn't do that. That's all. There's one point in history where we just say, okay, go, and after we said go, we can't do it back anymore. And that. And the release notes were updated after this point with at least three important updates that were called to the translator to say, please update the translation because there were very stupid errors in it. Yeah, that's what it works. And perhaps it might work a bit better if next time we really start with this pseudo package in time so that we have the updates in time. But I really doubt it because a lot of issues just came up in the last seconds. For example, we had a very nasty bug on Sendmail, so that if you upgraded Sendmail, with messages still being in the queue, the messages in the queue were ignored from Sendmail from that point on. There is a Perl script to circumvent it. We'd notice that, I would say, Friday evening, and there was no chance to re-upload Sendmail with a fix for it. So we just say we document it in the release notes, and we had to fix it, because it can't be that we say, oh, yeah, you updated Sendmail, you lost just some, well, 2,000 messages. Bad luck.
Okay, I think we'll have to end... and there, at least inside, again, you can feel free to continue the conversations outside.
I just let me say final thing about that. I will now just go back to the dorm, and whoever wants to speak with me, of course, is invited to do it now or at any time later. I'm really happy even to discuss about some more technical or more deep issues that are not possible to discuss here with so many people. And thank you all for coming to this talk. Okay. Thank you very much.
All right, so we need to clear out pretty quickly. If I can just make the announcement one more time, there's a bag out there for your plastic bottles and cans only, recyclable ones. And we can use the money we get from that to build up our patent portfolio.